with a range of coverages. More at progressivecommercial.com.
This is 1A. I'm Jen White, and you're listening to the Friday News Roundup. Job numbers rose last month, but so did unemployment. It's a mixed bag of a jobs report less than a week from the elections. It's a high-stakes midterm season, and last week's attack on the husband of House Speaker Nancy Pelosi has cast a pall over the proceedings. The assault has already become mired in conspiracy theories spread by several prominent figures, including the new head of Twitter. And that's where we start today, as a massive round of layoffs prompts a class action lawsuit. Alex Heath is deputy editor at The Verge, and he joins us now. Alex, welcome.
Hi, thanks for having me.
So Thursday, a group of former Twitter employees sued the company for violating California workplace law, and that's because new owner Elon Musk plans to eliminate half of Twitter's workforce and has apparently already started cutting jobs. What do we know about his plans to clear house and the implications of this lawsuit?
Yeah, the lawsuit was filed shortly after an unsigned memo was sent inside Twitter, the first real communication employees have received since Musk took the company over a week ago, saying that the company's going to go through a global reduction in its workforce. And while the memo didn't say the scope of the cuts, I'm hearing it's roughly half of Twitter's workforce. They have about 7,500 employees. And employees immediately started getting logged out of their internal systems, their work emails, even before they received an email telling them whether they were going to stay at the company or not. And as of this morning, received that notice, and you're right, several employees filed a lawsuit claiming that Twitter violated California's WARN Act, which requires employers to notify employees of the mass layoffs 60 days before. I am hearing that some of these, it's hard, you know, because you're operating in an information vacuum. Twitter isn't sharing this stuff with the press, but, you know, based on employees I've talked to who've gotten these notices, they will be kept on the payroll for at least 2 months. So this may be how Musk is trying to get out of a potential WARN Act violation. But it's really unclear. Things are moving very quickly, as usually happens with Musk.
Right, another big change. Musk has floated his attaching a price tag to the blue check that indicates a user is verified. So for people who don't use Twitter, what exactly is verification? What does that blue check mark mean?
Sure, verification on Twitter gives you a check mark by your name, and it was originally intended to signal that you are who you say you are. So it's actually Musk kind of returning it back to what it originally was supposed to be. It instead became this thing that you needed to know someone at Twitter to get, whether you were a celebrity, a politician, or a journalist. Musk sees it as a way to just say, I have linked a credit card to this account. I have verified that I'm a human being and not a bot. Musk, leading into this deal, made it very clear that he thinks Twitter has a bot problem, that there's too much spam on the site. And he sees this new paid verification, which is going to start rolling out next week, $8 a month, as a way to combat that. And anyone who currently has a blue check mark will need to pay within 90 days or lose their check mark.
How would monetizing it effectively cut back on the number of people who, the number of users on the site who aren't real people?
The idea is that linking a credit card to an account is a way to have an account go through an additional layer of verification that it's at least not, you know, someone operating a bot farm, right? Which is actually a problem Twitter has. And what's going to happen is the experience on Twitter is going to quickly bifurcate between whether you're verified or not. Musk has said that people who are verified will get preference in Twitter's algorithms, so they'll be seen by more people, they'll be seen higher in replies, they'll have a cleaner notification experience, but with the filter out non-verified. So you're really going to see a have-and-have-not situation here, where if you're verified, you see a lot of verified accounts, and if you're not, you are not seen by the verified accounts as much.
Well, there's been some back and forth about whether he's going to charge $8 or $20 a month. Has he landed on a price tag?
I have quickly realized with this week of Musk owning Twitter that anything can change on a dime. I think the team building this feature found out that it was going to be $8 instead of $20 for Musk's tweet. So they're all kind of looking to his Twitter account to determine what their next steps are. He's had employees was sleeping in the office, working 12-plus-hour shifts to build this feature, and has told the team building it that if they don't ship it on time next week, we'll all be fired. And keep in mind, this is as half of their colleagues are being laid off as we speak.
What do you think this means for the company as a whole? Do you think people are going to leave the site?
It's a good question. I've seen some analysis that roughly a million accounts have been deactivated since Musk took over. I think it's too early to say, frankly. I will say this is the most dramatic cultural reset of a company that I've ever witnessed. I mean, Twitter was the opposite of how Musk runs his companies leading into this. And he's really signaled that he's going to get rid of a lot of the perks and benefits, like a monthly day of rest and a work from anywhere policy and all these things that Twitter has touted to employees. And, you know, you can hold two things to be true. I think it's fair that Twitter has not moved as quickly as some of its other peers in social media. The company has kind of languished for the last decade relative to Facebook and others in terms of the innovation there. And it's also a fairly bloated company. There are probably more employees than they need. You know, Twitter, before Musk bought it, was going to already lay off about a fourth of the company. So they were already planning to reduce the headcount. Obviously, he's doing that more. So I think it's true that, you know, he recognizes bloat at the company and wants to get rid of it. He also has to do this because this is the largest leveraged buyout of a company by a single person ever. And he has $1 billion a year in interest payments on the debt alone. Twitter barely makes that in revenue. So he's got to make cuts to be able to pay back his debtors. So I think there's a bit of his hand is forced there as well.
We're talking to Alex Heath with The Verge. And let's bring in a couple of more voices. Wendy Benjaminson is a deputy managing editor for the U.S. government at Bloomberg News. Wendy, thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me, Jeff.
And Jeff Mason is with us. He's Reuters White House correspondent. Jeff, always great to have you.
Great to be with you.
Now, Elon Musk has called himself a free speech absolutist, but this week he indicated it would be at least a few weeks before any banned users return to the platform, and that includes former President Donald Trump. So, Jeff, this means Trump won't be on the platform for Election Day, but how much of a struggle has it been for him to reach people since getting kicked off other social media sites?
Well, he's found other ways to reach people. He has his own social media site now, Truth Social. And the former president has even indicated that if he were given the opportunity to come back onto Twitter, that he would not, because he wouldn't want to draw people away from Truth Social. That said, I think all of us who covered him for the 4 years that he was president, and others clearly who have followed him all these years, know how much he likes to have a big audience, and he had millions of followers, many more than he has on his current site. So I suspect if Mr. Musk did make it possible for him to return, that it would be hard for the former president to say.
Wendy, if Trump and other figures known for spreading mis- and disinformation are allowed back, what concerns does that raise for you around the proliferation of conspiracy theories and disinformation?
Well, I think there will be much more conspiracy theories and misinformation, and that's always a problem for our democracy. I would hope that if he is a free speech absolutist, he lets people call out what our conspiracy theories are not. He certainly didn't help that. After Paul Pelosi was attacked with a hammer in his home, someone tweeted a wild conspiracy theory that's not fact-based at all. And he tweeted, you know, in his sort of, well, there's certainly more to the story here than meets the eye. That legitimizes a conspiracy theory, and that's the biggest concern with Musk taking over, is him using his influence to legitimize these ideas.
Hey, Alex, what does it say that the new owner of this platform himself is spreading misinformation?
I would just say this isn't a new thing, right? Musk has tweeted things that are really cringe or kind of stoke a conspiracy theory and deleted it before. He's a guy who kind of shoots from the hip. He's talked about how Twitter is his stream of consciousness. He doesn't really think before he tweets. He obviously was sued over tweeting saying that he was going to take Tesla private and he didn't do it. So he's shown in the past that he really doesn't care, frankly. So I think we're going to just see more of that now that he's the self-described chief twit.
Well, Twitter's own employees warn that the trolls are currently testing the platform's limits with a surge of racist slurs, anti-Semitic memes, a lot of hate-filled language. So, Alex, what does all this mean for the future of the platform?
said to advertisers he doesn't want Twitter to become a, quote, hellscape, that he wants it to be the best advertising platform in the world. That suggests he thinks that moderation is important because advertisers, we know, do not want to be next to, you know, content that is hateful or racist, etc. So he has incentive to make the platform a clean place because he needs to make money. He can't afford for this to be a vanity project that doesn't make money. So that is the only hope I see in terms of his incentives for keeping it a safe place.
Well, it's important to note that some advertisers have paused on their advertising on the site while they're watching this all play out. We're talking to Alex Heath of The Verge, Bloomberg's Wendy Benjaminson, and Reuters' Jeff Mason. Coming up, what more do we know about the attack on Paul Pelosi, and what can we expect from next week's midterm elections? I'm Jen Wyatt. We'll be back with more in just a moment. This is 1-8 from WAMU and NPR.
Memoir, now out in paperback, is about growing up black and gay in a church community that insists